Hey guys, really quick before we get started on this episode, if you think you might like a Fireside t-shirt or other cool Fireside swag, including back rubs, be sure to check out our Patreon page and consider becoming a patron of the Fireside Tattoo Network. It helps us continue to provide free content to you guys, and then you get a little gift as well. The link is below. Please check it out. We would greatly appreciate it. Enjoy the episode.
Hold on, let me clap. Do you ever use the clap to like? No, we need to use it to like line anything up. Oh shit. Well, it looks cooler whenever I do. Hey, welcome to the Fireside Tattoo Podcast here at Star, Texas. Convention.
Is that why we clap?
Yeah, that's why we clap. Clap for the Star, Texas. We're fortunate enough to snag Aaron Springs for a second year in a row. We're gonna see if we can. See if we can get kicked off of YouTube tonight.
It's fucking bullshit. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was trying to control my language, but I just can't.
Can we do a bullshit counter or a yeah?
Put bullshit. It right here.
Yeah, just click every time.
Fuck that!
Fuck that noise. So we were talking about doing one at your shop. That'd be a lot more fun. It's tough podcasting at these places because. I mean, people are here to work, not to sit and talk about tattoos. So, like, half the time we sit around, like, twiddle our thumbs, do nothing.
Yeah, I don't know. We kind of always talk about tattoos as it is. So, yep. I think the tattoos are pretty much used to it.
Yeah.
No big deal.
Yeah, yeah. So, you worked on a, what was, a swan.
Like, yeah.
Swan today.
Swan. Yeah, it was okay. I couldn't get into that drawing too much. It was one of those days where you just kind of. I couldn't get it going.
I thought the drawing looked pretty solid.
Yes. I think people just like Japanese flowy stuff with flowers. People are like,
That is true.
I feel like you're in my brain right now.
It's really?
I can hear you exceptionally well.
Is it really loud?
No, it's all good.
Okay. If I get a little closer to the mic.
I'm just trying to break the awkwardness.
Is it? I don't know. It's no awkwardness.
Is it awkward? It's awkward right
not
now.
Not to me.
Fuck that.
So let's talk a little bit about tattoos before you tell us about your near-death experience.
No, dude, I'm not going to. Look, I'm just going to tell you guys that I almost died jerking off, right? If you want the full story,
go to aaronsprings.com.
Come to the shop and get it that way because
it's the bio
way
link.
Too embarrassing to be online, right?
How do you just leave it at that, though? Man,
it is. Like, we got to move on. My parents are probably going to watch this, and I think that's the worst. I'm sure they can already figure it out. My dad's like fucking super smart.
Yeah?
Super smart.
And he just knows you would have gone wrong?
He knows.
I'm going to guess you were driving.
No. I got to fucking tell the story now, huh? See, I know what you're doing.
I'm trying to do it. It's like a trivia. No, not driving.
I can't do it, man. I can't tell. It's too embarrassing.
All right. All right. You
guys want the story. You just come ask me. Or you're getting tattooed or Compton's tattooing you. More than likely to tell you the story. I almost died jerking off.
Was he involved somehow?
No.
Oh, okay. All right. All right. So let's talk about tattooing for just a second. Since the last time we talked to you, I was, you know, I'd paid attention to your, to kind of the new school stuff that you do most of the time. And then I started seeing like these portraits and things like that, kind of like illustrative realism stuff coming from you that I don't think I knew about the last time that we talked. as a percentage, are you doing a lot of realism? Are you trying to move in that direction at all? It's not, I don't guess it's really realism. It's pretty realistic.
Yeah, that's me trying to do realism. yeah, so I think it still kind of comes across illustrative.
Like illustrative.
I think a lot of that comes from me doing what I know works as a good tattoo. You know what I'm saying? So, like, there's certain things that work as a good tattoo, like lots of black, high contrast, probably some evident separation of values and stuff, something that, you know, that the eye can read. You know, people are dumb, right? And so they we got to create something.
Yeah.
That gotta really, and I talk about this all the time, we got to create something, and it's a good and a bad thing. We got to create something, us as tattooers now. We have to create something in, like, a 2x2, 2.5x2, 2.5 inches square. Uh-huh. And what is that? That's on your phone, right? We got to create something that fits in this box, right? And not to undermine all these tattooers that have done, like Andreas is a perfect example. He has the best tattoo, and it just worked out. They're brilliant tattoos, but they're perfect. You know what I'm saying? They're high contrast. They have everything they need to be. Grab the reader's attention, but that goes in for all tattoos. I think it's we have to create something that grabs the reader's view. So I think it's just me, like, consistently thinking of that.
Yeah.
And I think that just makes my realism become more illustrative, more linear, not so tonal edges, not so feathery and realistic. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. I just want to do a tattoo that's gonna last for 20 years. So everything kind of seems very.
Yeah.
Very linear.
That's, yeah, you know, and you bring that up, and it's a good point that, like, we have to catch, it's almost like, you know, it's not just the tattoo for the client, but you almost can't let it out of your mind that it has to catch someone's attention when they're flipping
it
through their
feed.
It's
all about right here. And, like, it's a good and a bad thing because it makes us evolve towards a certain direction. And that, it can be a bad thing because it really meant, starts changing who you are as an artist, right? Yeah. So now I got to create something that grabs the reader's attention in a space this big really fast. You get one flip, right? Little scroll. You flip through Instagram, you're like, fuck that piece.
Yeah.
Fuck that piece. And then you're just like, oh, what's that? And you're like, oh, it's so pretty. Yeah. Right? So what is that?
Right.
What makes that happen? And so, yeah, so all these tattooers are just kind of getting tunneled into whatever that is, you know, and it's cool. It's cool if you can do it and not drive yourself crazy with it. I always kind of defined it as, like, you need to have a product to sell, right? So Andreas has got this amazing product to sell, right? And it fits perfectly in this little square. The dude's fucking stoked, right? Yeah. Because he loves doing them, right? And it's a great tattoo.
Does
and
he still love doing roses?
Yeah. Right, they're gorgeous and stuff. So yeah, I mean, he does all sorts of things. So
right.
It's kind of, I get asked the same question. I've done like 100 roses in the last 3 weeks. So yeah, it's just whatever. It's just grabbing it. If it's something that I like to do and my viewers like to see it, then I'm stoked to do it.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, I have noticed you've done a lot of flowers lately. And you know something that always like jumps out to me about your flowers right from the start is like the really strong kind of cast shadows from a petal onto another petal, stuff like that. A lot of people don't pay attention to that, or they'll leave drop shadows and stuff out.
Right.
And I think that stuff, for one thing, it makes it believable, and it's another element of like contrast or another step in value that you can use, makes another shape and all that kind of stuff. But for whatever reason, that's just stood out to me. The few we've actually reposted a few of your flowers lately on some of our social media.
Yeah, thanks,
and it's,
a lot, man.
Oh yeah, man, absolutely.
We're working on like a super hard burp right now, so that's kind of why my face looks like it's about to have diarrhea. That's just all stuff I've learned from Andreas. I've learned so much from that dude. But one thing he always talks about is the chroma scale. You know, adding grays into your, and I could be wrong, the definition of that, but adding grays into your tattoos, it really sells it. You know, it's just one extra step of the contrast, you know, just the cool colors are there to contrast the bright colors. And
and more kind of are like in desaturation too. Like as it gets darker, it's like not as you lose the, like, the brightness of the hue, and you get more muted. And so that makes the brighter tones look even brighter.
So you already know more shit than I do.
No, that's exactly what you're
a real artist.
That's exactly what you're doing though. It's like you're getting these, you're the effects that you're pulling. The people will all the time be like, they'll email in or whatever, or send stuff to social media. And if we're doing like a technique episode, or we're showing someone like you, we're putting their work up as we're talking, and they're like, what inks are they using, or what inks are you guys using? I can't get my whatever. My reds aren't that bright. My yellows aren't that bright. Yeah. It's like, it's the same. It's what, like Yogi was saying, it's tattoo inks. That's what inks I'm using. Like, it's not the how bright that is or how saturated that is. It's how it looks compared to what's surrounding it.
Exactly. Yeah. How it's saturated. Exactly. Yeah.
So, or contrast. I think
put all that black in a tattoo. People were like, "I think I'm gonna put color in it." That's exactly. I was doing a black swan just a while ago, and she was like, "Are you gonna add color? Are we doing black and gray?" And I'm like, "I need a shitload of black to make those colors really vibrant. That's what makes it."
Yeah, I think it's interesting that because you've been tattooing. Remind me again how long you've been tattooing?
Professionally, somewhere around 5 or 6 years.
Because you were a cop before that, right?
I was.
I remember that, too.
Just turned my badge in last December.
Is that for real?
Yeah.
Just turned it in?
Yeah. Not this last December. A year ago.
Oh.
Yeah.
So you were tattooing, and we may have talked about this before. I don't know.
I was tattooing full-time, and then I was just doing – I worked as a reserve officer for a college in Alvin.
Okay.
So they held my commission, and I worked like once or twice a week. Once or twice a month, and serve my community.
Hell yeah.
They enjoyed that.
Serve those fuckers. Right?
Ding.
I lost my train of thought a little bit, but what I was going to say was that you came up in a time where social media was already pretty prevalent, and so it's funny how that is like that's like a balancing act that you've had from the very start. Like, well, I have to satisfy this customer and also have to make something that works really well in a 2x2
product,
square.
Yeah.
That like a product. Yeah, think of it as a product. It has to. It's almost like your brand.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's a strong thing to have, man. If you can just have one of those little things to sell to people, mm-hmm. I mean, it's like you're getting these followers. It's just business. It's business. So you know that's what people want to see. They want to have their attention grasped in a little square.
Yeah.
And so, hey, if you can create something that you don't mind doing in that that space, hey, you got it made, right?
Yeah.
You got clients. And
so you and that also, I would imagine, makes it a lot easier for you, like, to have control over, like, say, if you sit down to do a consultation or something like that, they're probably a lot more trusting of your ideas because they came to you more for your brand than for their idea. Was that fair to say?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if you have a product that you're selling, yeah, absolutely. They already know what they're coming to get, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah, there you go. God, I saw it coming.
It was kind of weak, though. There's still more there.
It felt like a lot of buildup for kind of just.
Yeah, that was weak. I know. It was not satisfying.
What happened to everyone else this weekend? Normally, you guys have a whole row, like run the place.
Yeah, Compton's getting ready to go to Milan, and Mason's coming up. I think he had something else to do. Sean is just staying at home. Yeah, no one's really traveling. I'm not going to do a lot of conventions this year either. I'm going to stay home. Going back to taking some art classes and.
Oh no shit! Yeah, where?
Glissell. It's the art museum of Houston. They got like a small fine art school. It's like a non-accredited college, but I've taken a couple courses there before, and it's nice.
What's your goal there? Are you going to try to work on like?
I'm going to take color theory this year. It's something I could be better at for sure. Hue and all those words.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't even know what my primary color was and primary colors were until I worked next to Andreas.
Really?
That's fucking stupid, right? That tells you a lot about the psychology of color, if you think about that. Like, I made it really far to work with those guys, not knowing a fucking thing, but just trusting your instincts, right? Just like, this feels right, that doesn't feel right. So the psychology of color is a motherfucker, man. It's crazy.
Yeah.
So, you know,
the
worst things happen is what feels right, you know? That's, that's wild.
That is crazy. If you really have – that you're obviously making good color choices because it's showing in your work and people are responding to it and all that, but you have really no idea why. You're just going completely on instinct. And I wonder if going through color theory, you'll like – justify a lot of stuff that you already thought, or be like, "Oh shit,
probably
I don't do that."
Screwed up.
Yeah, like I don't do that shit at all. That's not how I thought.
I've worked a lot of that over a lot of the color theory stuff over the last 4 or 5 years with Andreas and Compton and Sean and stuff like that.
Yeah,
those guys are all pretty knowledgeable about it.
Yeah.
So sorry, man.
Did they all have art backgrounds? Everyone else in the shop except for you, or no?
Sean has been drawing since like Jesus walked the earth, and Compton's pretty much the same. Everyone had a pretty rich art history. They all kind of grew up drawing and stuff like that.
But like art college, art college?
No,
stuff like
I don't
that?
Think anyone no. went to art school. I went to art school when I got out of the high school. I think I was the only one. Yeah.
And I didn't learn shit.
Didn't learn
right?
Yeah. So
idiot.
What if you were to – you're going to take some art classes, not travel so much, try to work on stuff at home. Any interest in taking on, like, bigger projects, moving into larger scale stuff, anything
I
like –
I think so.
Yeah?
yeah, for sure. I think that's something I'm going to tackle more this year. Huh. I think just because I'm getting a better idea of how things, you know, heal and what tools I should be using in my tattoo, what size liners, you know, for larger scale tattoos. I'm getting a better understanding of that stuff, you know. Yeah. Before working on big stuff, I would do like a sleeve and I would just have to keep coming back to the one section where I worked on. It's just like, yeah. It's unreasonable because I'm never satisfied with that. Yeah. I need to just be able to keep going. So I feel like I'm coming more to that for sure.
Yeah. I'd be interested to see how that translates for you and how you translate that, what you're doing to larger scale. Yeah. I think you could really, a lot of what you're doing, you could literally just like blow up and let the body crop a lot of it and not even have to add a lot more as far as elements go. Because you've got a lot of interesting things already happening, at this scale, I think you could blow them up and they would get maintained there.
I love working on a larger scale. It's way more relaxing.
How so?
It's just bigger fields, you know, you're not having to get in there and Andreas it, like, you know, he'll be like, hour and a half, and I'm like, oh man, it's sick, and I'm like, gah, you know, fuck that,
are we doing the counter in a different spot each time?
We'll add it in,
yeah, like, it's like,
the
here,
fuck bucket, call it
yeah.
the fuck bucket,
fuck bucket. Well, that'll be interesting. Interesting.
I really try to like take advantage of that. I can cuss in my job and not give a fucking shit. Who's it? You know, it's cool. I'm like, I'm a greasy tattooer.
Yeah,
I like that.
Remember when they first started? Like satellite radio, thought they were doing something big. They bring Howard Stern on. And you're like, hey, we don't have to watch our language in this, and you can pay $9 a month, and you can listen to people cuss on the radio, and then like podcasts came along, and it's like, well, shit. Yeah. When it's like. That wasn't worth anything at all, was it? I mean, now everybody can do that. I lost my train of thought again.
Three. What? We'll have a burp bucket, too.
Good.
Sorry. This is a shitty podcast. It's my fault, man.
Sorry. It's going great. I think it's going great.
Cool. All right.
I feel good about it.
You're rocking, then.
Let's keep going. So, moving into... You got me all screwed up.
It's cool, man. Take your time.
Thanks. Are we good? Can we just hang for a couple of minutes?
We can put it on pause and go get more beer.
We do need to do that. Yeah. Can we take a pause break?
They're having boxing fights tonight, right?
Yeah. You're not going to go to that?
Man, I got a draw still and stuff.
You're tattooing tomorrow?
Yeah.
I think we're going to go to it. Are you a fighter?
No.
I thought it was like.
I got hit in the ear like twice one time. It was the worst thing ever. And I'm just like, no, I don't want to fight. I'm not a fighter. Yeah.
I thought it was like, you know, a charity thing and just tattooers get together and nobody really trained and maybe you wore those big gloves or the sumo suits or something like that.
And then they all
just
got like, serious, right? They
apparently it's really serious. Have you seen it before?
No, I haven't.
I haven't either.
It seems very intense.
We were talking to Corey James, a tattooer from somewhere around here, this area, and he's fighting tonight. He's not tattooing because he's fighting in this thing. And he's been like seriously training. He was here with his trainer. He's got like marks on his head and stuff and where he's been getting punched. And it's like, is it pretty serious? You've been really training? He's like, oh, yeah, dude, I've been, like, seriously training. Like, well, shit, I thought I was going to be, as you know, I mean, for a tattooer, I'm in pretty good shape. When you walk up and down these aisles, I'm in better shape than most of these guys. Like, I should jump in and fight somebody. And then I saw him all, like, trained up all, like, callous knuckles and busted face. I'm like, well, shit.
Yeah, the guy's probably not even trained. He's going to go waddle
exactly.
in. He's like, wait, hold on. Who am I fighting?
That's exactly what's going to happen.
Did we drug test him? Prohibited substance list.
Somebody's going to walk in there and just get blitzed, which will be fun. You should hang out for a while and go see it.
Yeah, I will. I'll probably go.
Yeah. You recently got tattooed by Timmy. Timmy B.
Yep.
What? So you've been tattooed by, because that's Victor Chill, who I got to watch Victor since then. I went to the Venetian gathering. We podcasted the thing in Venice, and I was set up next to Victor, and I didn't really talk to him because he doesn't seem to speak a lot of English.
Yeah.
But but I watched him.
No, he speaks English. I got some stories, but I know we talked about Victor last time.
We did a little bit last
time. Man, that fucking guy. I love that guy, dude. Yeah. He is hilarious.
Yeah.
Let me give you an idea, like what it's like to hang out with Victor. Okay, so you did a podcast with Abel recently, right?
Last year
you did.
Yep.
So Abel, super nice dude, right? Mm-hmm. Victor was staying at my house, and he came down for a guest spot, and it was at the shop. And this is kind of what it's like hanging out with Victor. So he just like doesn't care. It's like about anything. He just wants to joke all the time, and I'm just totally into that.
Yeah.
And so he was setting up for a tattoo, and Abel walked in. Abel hadn't met this fucking dude once, dude. Hadn't met him once. And he just walked in, and Abel's like, "Hey, nice to meet you." And he's like, "Oh, you're Abel, right?" And he's like, "Yeah." He's like, "You do the traditional tattoos, huh?" He's like, "Yeah, man." He's like, "Yeah, it's okay. Traditionally, you know, it's for the gay boys, but whatever, you know, it's cool. We let you do it." And I was just like, "God, this fucking guy is awesome, right?" Just totally made fun of this tattoo. I was like, "I wish it had the balls. You know, I'd probably get hit in the ear again." And of course, we're just laughing about that. Abel's just like, "Oh, your tattoos are going to disappear in a year or something." You know, just whatever. Just right. Like started chiming in on each other.
Right.
And so we had a massage table set up, and Victor's over here setting up. He's like, "Abel, I want to show you a good trick." But he was like serious. You know, I was like, man, I was like, "Well, shit, we're about to learn something." And he's like, "Abel, I want you to come over here, and I want you to lay on the table, okay? Lay on the table. I'll show you something. It's very good for a tattoo." And Abel's like, "Oh, fuck yeah, all right, cool, whatever." And Abel's just like buying it. And I'm like, this dude's been staying with me for like a day and a half, so I kind of know there's like some shit about to happen, right? And Abel just comes in like, he's like, "Oh, yeah, just lay down. And Abel just kind of like, he just like lays down on the table, right? He's like, "Okay, now you look to this guy. Look to, you know," he's totally selling the fact that he doesn't speak English, but it's bullshit because he speaks English better than that. You know what I'm saying? But he's just like totally selling it. He's like, "Now you look to this guy. And Abel's like, "All right, cool." He's just like this. And Victor like, "And let me see your legs." And he grabs both his legs and pulls them up. And he grabs a paper towel and he goes, "Now you wipe the baby. It's so fucking Abel, this big old round Mexican boy sitting here like this with his legs up here, getting his fucking ass wiped by Victor Chimota. Oh my God, I laughed so hard, I was crying, man.
That's awesome.
That's just what it's like working with that guy all the time.
I should have spent more time around his booth. Then I just like he was focused.
Wipe the baby.
That's awesome. Oh, he was. He seemed focused, and I just like, maybe he plays that card. I know other people that do that, like the people that use. I guess I would use my language barrier to my advantage too if I were tattooing in other countries. What I was going to ask is like, so you've been tattooed by Victor, Timmy, and then you know, I'm working with all the other guys that you guys all work in a similar style. Are most people's processes kind of the same? Like, or do you see him? Are you like shocked whenever? I'm shocked, but like, do you see like people working in a new school style, taking completely different paths to get there, or is everyone kind of using the same process?
Kind of the same. Yeah. Most people put their line work in, and then like their black, and then color, and then just do their line work. Timmy does his line work at the end, kind of. Victor kind of has an idea, I think, of where he wants his black lines to be, but he probably does it the same way. We all kind of do it the same thing.
It's all
for
done
the
about
part.
The same.
Kelly Doty, I think, is the only person. Kelly and Lindsay. It might be a chick thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. They do their line work and black work, and then I think they start at the top and then just slowly, methodically go. They finish like, you know, like a typewriter kind of going down.
Color and everything?
They're just like finishing? All the way to white.
Yeah, and just like a lot of the realism.
Steady. Yeah, I like that approach because I think it's less painful for your client.
Yeah,
I've tried to do that a couple times. It's not really for me. I'm kind of all over the place.
Man, I'm the same way. I struggle with that. Another person we were set up next to in Venice was Steve Butcher, and that guy, like, it's like you're watching a printer like print, and it's fully finished. And that
guy, same way too, Steve Wimmer.
Oh, really?
Have you seen a Steve Wimmer portrait?
No, that's really nice.
It's beautiful, man.
Who is that? Steve who?
Steve Wimmer.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
This guy is one of my number one inspirations. Yeah. He inspired me to do the color portraits. When I seen it, I was like, man, that's what I want to do right there.
Yeah, that's really nice.
He did both these at one time.
Where is he out of?
He's a San Diego now, I think. He was in Delaware, and he just moved to San Diego recently. Yeah.
Huh. Yeah. Yeah, that's really nice. And he finished. He does that way.
Yeah.
He works that way.
Yeah. Right. Right. I think he comes back and gets some white in there or something. Yeah. And shapes it up, but for the most part, just start to finish. That's how I do my portraits too. For the main part, yeah.
So you don't go through and lay all your blacks in and then come back?
Yeah. Color portraits and realism, I pretty much try to get the majority of it completed. I'm not as confident as I'd like to be in getting it all the way to the last tone, but yeah, for the most part.
So what, I mean, the thing that confuses me in that approach is, like, I guess you're working enough from the photo that you know, like, this light on this chin is the same light that's on the forehead right here, and so you're just always kind of coming. Like, you're always comparing, when you get to here, you're comparing it to value, from a value color standpoint, to what you did here. Is that right? So you're like,
yeah, and then also, like, as you get a little bit further along, you're seeing, like, how the colors are settling and stuff like that. So if you might need to go a little bit dark, so it's kind of really important. So when you go at the beginning, I kind of get some nerves going, and I want to kind of get going, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. But it's real important, just bite that shit and swallow it and just kind of just slow it down. That way you just can really look to see how your colors are settling in the skin. If you need to go darker.
Diker.
Yeah. Yeah. You need to go more butch with that color right there.
So you will, like, you'll get to a point and then be like, yeah, man, that my darks aren't dark enough. I need to come back and blast through those and then pick back up going forward. Yeah, man, I guess just because I kind of like you, I'm just working all around. I'm always thinking about, like, my light source, and so I'm trying to get all my darks laid in, and then all my, more of a, you know, like, your regular approach. And when I watch someone like Steve Butcher go through, and, like, you know, it's not like he's doing one big shape. That dude's got, like, the thing I watched him do is, like, a tiger jumping out of water with probably 200 cherry blossoms and leaves behind it. So, I mean, it's like, you know, that he's, like, making little marks that he's filling little areas that are, like, peppery little things everywhere.
So much detail,
so
water
much,
droplets.
So dude, much going on. I just have
in the fucking face. There's no way I'm gonna do that. It doesn't seem like a fun time to
me. Are your stencils like theirs? Whenever you do your
nose, my shit is this, like, here's the eyes, the nose, the mouth. Here's the highlights.
Yeah,
and then pretty much just try to rock and roll.
And I cannot wrap my mind around those stencils that are like that. I can't even see, like, at all. There's almost no skin because it's like purple lines are so tight and so close together.
Yeah. I don't get it, man. It's not for me.
How does this Steve Wimmer, how's he have
pretty simple. Yeah, not too crazy. Too. Yeah. He's got his values kind of highlighted, you know.
Yeah.
Nothing crazy.
Yeah. All right. Well, good. That's good for how other people tattoo. I was just curious because having a lot of work by a lot of people who work similarly to you. I didn't know if there were a lot of different approaches. So that's what that was.
Most time it's just line work, black work, color.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Most guys, I used to be real methodical about that. I would put in my line work, my black work, my dark red, then my medium red, you know, and then my light red. You know, I put the dark red everywhere in there. Kind of not appropriate,
not quite like
but if, you know, if you're starting off, it's a good way to do it. Because you're putting in your dark red and you're moving on to the next dark red spot, and then you can kind of be looking at that spot and seeing if you need to go darker or more true or wherever you need
to go. So are you saying you go through and do all of your, like, all of one color or just what?
Yeah.
And then work into another color and then work into another color? Huh.
Yeah. Kind of weird way, but I did that for years and
it worked
for me.
Huh. Yeah, I'd never.
It's just not a super confident way to approach your tattoo, but if you're starting with something basic, you know, fire truck, right? You line work, you do all your line work on the fire truck, you do all your black work on the firework, and you got a dark red. And I would just put the dark red in everywhere, right? And then medium red, light red, white.
Yeah.
That's kind of how I did it.
Yeah, yeah, I got you. So moving in, staying at home some more this year and starting some art classes. Are you trying to focus on other mediums at all? Or
yeah,
is this all
oil
just
painting.
For
oil painting.
Oh,
for
really?
Sure. Yeah, yeah. I've already started like 3 or 4 pieces this year.
Huh.
So
how do you
forward to that.
Are you? Is it frustrating so far? Or you think you're picking it
super
up?
Super frustrating. Yeah. It's I've messed with oil before, but I've never really gone into the depths that I'm going now. I'm like really digging deep, trying to Like, I'm doing a painting right now that's it's kind of a self-portrait. I put my head in a box with, like, some packing peanuts in there, you know, styrofoam packing peanuts.
Yeah.
And, dude, like, the styrofoam packing peanuts are just damn it, dude. I mean, just, like, the subtle hints of gray and cool, but then just warm and light and just, like, and having to create the shadow because I made it up, you know? So it's, like, having to create these shadows and super challenging, man.
So you're wet. So the portrait you're painting, kind of from a photo of yourself, and the rest of it you're inventing.
And then I just
kind of
added it in there. Yeah, I'm trying to keep it more realistic and stuff like that. Yeah.
Are you using like a traditional approach where you're building up thin layers? Or are you like putting like chunks of paint down, like building it instantly?
Yeah, not heavy alla prima, but I'm trying to get a layer on there as good as I can.
Right? Yeah. I've been.
If I could do it once and just do it once, that'd be great.
I'm the same way. I tend to paint I like to pilot paint. I try to go around and take painting workshops from not tattoo related stuff at all, but like really good life painters, like figure painters, portrait painters, whatever. Yeah. So I'll go and do week long workshops with different artists. And I don't know if you know Casey Ball, but he's amazing. Yeah, he's a badass. Painter. And I took a workshop from him once, and it was one of my earliest workshops. And I remember him telling me like,
"What's up, good looking?"
I remember him telling me that that I needed more paint on the canvas. He's like, you need to get paint on the canvas so you can move it around, man. Yeah. He's like, you're like drawing before there's enough paint to draw with, like to work with. And so, sure enough, man, I watch him, and like first off, he can nail the value and the color like at once. Like it's not like he's like sneaking up on anything. That dude just mixes it. He's looking at the person, not a photograph, looking at the person. He's just like, blop forehead, blop this, and it's just like looks like this kind of muddy sculpture,
right.
And then he can basically take a dry brush and scoot it around, and it turns into a photorealistic portrait. It's real crazy.
Alla prima painters are amazing.
Yeah, man, like absolutely crazy. And so I was really drawn to that method, and now we've got Nick Baxter's coming to Memphis to do a painting workshop at my studio in a few months, and I've been paying closer attention to the way his approach. Oh my God! It's like a classical master's, thin glaze over the longest period of time, and they turn out looking so rich and like
so
beautiful.
Amazing. Yeah.
But holy shit! I think I would lose my mind trying to do it.
I'm ready for it. I was hoping Nick was. Is he working here?
I talked to him a couple of weeks ago, and he said that he thought he was going to be out of town, was going to be in town, and was looking for a booth to share. But I guess he didn't find one.
I was looking. I'm going to do some painting before I leave. Like I said, my ranch is right down the road, so
yeah,
just gonna do some painting for you to see if you'd join me, man.
Yeah,
he's biggest inspiration I've had. Him and Jeff both are biggest inspirations I've had tattooing, man. And they just continue to, astonish me. And just damn, nicking those paintings,
it's crazy.
So good, man. I've been all over the world now, you know, and I've seen all these art museums and the Louvre and all this shit. I like Nick's shit better than all that crap, man. Yeah. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah, it is. Crazy. It's nuts, man. I love
it's
how
really
he's
cool that guy's part of our tattoo community.
Yeah.
You know? And like, that's badass.
I wonder how much longer we'll even know him as a tattooer, and he's just going to be like a
– I think just he likes
fucker.
Tattooing.
Yeah.
And he probably will always do it as long as he can, for sure.
Yeah, he's just – his paintings are getting to a level that I wonder if they – like his like popularity as a painter won't surpass his popularity as a tattooer, just because painting's
I'm
bigger
surprised
business.
It hasn't at this point, man. But I have no idea what exposure is like for being a painter. I don't know what that's like. I imagine it's difficult. So.
Yeah, and especially, you know, his subject matter is a little bit crazy.
It
for
is.
Like,
people are like, oh, it's not a fucking landscape with some cows? I don't know if I can get into this, you know?
Yeah. And, you know, you've got
bloody
to, like,
gloves.
bloody gloves. A lot of, like, bags of blood and stuff like
awesome.
That, but it's all beautiful. But I think people that's the challenge for painters like him. It's like just even finding some place to show. Like if you're in New York or something like that, you can't just walk through galleries and see like paintings of bags of blood or anything.
Did you hear about a long time ago Mayor Giuliani? He had a degenerate art show. And I had to do in my art history class, I had to do a paper. I chose Ron Geyer or something, a sculptor. Very, very, I guess you would say controversial art, whatever.
Yeah.
Anyways, there was this like a whole bunch of artists that just like, you know, shit had vaginas in it and dicks and pussies and whatever and all this crap, you know.
Right.
And Mayor Giuliani said, nah, we're not going to have that in our city. And so they put on what's called a degenerate art show. You can Google it. It's pretty tight. And just amazing art. But it's sad that it's like that because art should be, you know, whatever comes across your crazy mind, you know.
Yeah, it should. And it can be, I guess. It's just like finding a market for it is a little bit is a little bit tricky. But what I was going to say about Nick is one thing that, that impresses me so much about him is that he started, you know, he's always, as a tattooer, he got famous for being very, like, macro, up on stuff, like really close, really detailed, like you're looking at the textures of a thing, you know. And then he goes and starts trying to paint, like, landscapes, like distant landscapes, which is the exact opposite of any – like anything that he's ever been good at before, ever like has ever worked towards before.
Right.
And I was talking to him. We were doing a show with him. It was at that same convention in Venice. We were doing a show with him, and I asked him about like that transition, like how you're moving to like trying to paint something that's like a mile in the distance from painting like pores on the skin. You know, like is that hard? He was like, dude, I cannot. It's like I almost can't do it because I want to render every little thing to the fullest, and then I'm looking at a mountain, and I can see all these details in it, and I'm trying to paint them, and it looks all fucked up in the painting.
Right, right.
Yeah.
God, that's so frustrating for me. I do that all the time.
Really?
You know? Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Just, like, being able to, like, see something and then filter it in your own mind, be like, all right, what's the least I can get away with? Like, how few marks can I put down to make it look like that?
Right.
And then render it fuller as it gets closer to me or whatever. That's a challenge for...
It's a challenge, for sure. I get it.
Yeah. So. Yeah. But it's, I mean, that's what makes him so good, though. It's like he's just always looking for something else to challenge
absolutely.
Himself.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. Right,
Baxter, a.k.a. Jesus.
Tat
Jesus.
He is a tat Jesus. And his freaking Instagram.
Nari, come here. Come here.
Hop on up.
Come here. You guys know Nari? The threat?
We don't know. We don't know
come
Nari.
Have a seat. Come here. What's come here. Don't make it weird. All right. Whatever, dude. How's it going, brother? This guy's awesome, man.
Hey,
this guy's fucking awesome.
Nice to meet you. I'm Jake.
He works with Zach Singer's shop. Zach Singer?
Okay. Yeah, we're doing a podcast with Zach. I guess when he finishes up tonight. Or if he, maybe he's already finished. I don't know.
Yeah. All right. Get the hell out of here, man.
Yeah, right in the middle of the show.
I love you.
All right. Have we covered it all? What else? That wasn't very vulgar.
I know, man. It's fucking bullshit. I'll try looking harder next time.
It's probably me because I didn't come up with any really controversial questions like, you know, fuck, I don't know. I don't want to start it now.
Yeah. I wanted it to, like, tell some really gnarly stories, but I just it just reemphasizes to myself how much of a pussy I really am.
Because you just won't say it. Yeah. It's that you have it all planned until you said.
But now I
got to
tell you this jerking off dying
story. I've got to know about that. Maybe we should call it quits, get a beer, and talk about almost dying while jerking
off. Sounds good.
Thanks, man.
Hey, thanks, man. Thanks
always
for
a pleasure.
Always
good to see you. TattooImprovement.com. Sign up. We'll see you guys later.